Welcome to the Widowed Parent Podcast with your host, Jenny Lisk.
Hey everyone, it's Jenny Lisk, and this is episode 19 of the Widowed Parent Podcast. Today we're going to really focus in on the grief piece of the widowed parenting puzzle. It can be really hard for widowed parents to know how to help their children with their grief, because most of us don't have much experience nor any education in this. And so I'm really glad to share with you today my discussion with Buffy Peters and Sasha Mudloff from Hamilton's Academy of Grief and Loss in Des Moines, Iowa. Hamilton's is Iowa's largest funeral home, and 20 years ago they decided to start providing grief and loss support to their clients and to the broader community as well. And if you're not in Iowa, not to worry, they have fantastic and free resources available on their website. I'll link to them in the show notes. I learned so much from talking with Buffy and Sasha. Some topics we covered include handling questions from kids, including when you don't know the answer, the importance of telling kids the truth about tough situations, language to avoid when talking with kids about death, secondary losses experienced by kids who have lost a parent, undue burdens that may unintentionally be placed on kids, misconceptions that adults may have about children's grief, why it's important for kids to see the adults around them grieve and modeling healthy grieving, how children's grief differs from adult grief, and why it's important for adults to validate kids' feelings of grief. I hope you enjoy my discussion with Sasha Mudloff and Buffy Peters. My guests today are Buffy Peters and Sasha Mudloff from Hamilton's Academy of Grief and Loss. They are joining us from their office in Des Moines, Iowa. Sasha and Buffy, welcome.
Thank you, Jenny.
So first of all, I have to say, you guys have so much fabulous information and so many grief resources that you've put together. And so I'm going to have lots and lots of links to share with listeners on the show notes page and send them over to your website, because you have so many free, downloadable, printable resources. And I want to make sure that people know about that. And I'm really excited to be talking with you today so that you can tell us all about it.
Wonderful.
So before we get more into that, I'd love to hear a little bit more about, you know, who you guys are and what you do. So first of all, what is Hamilton's? And then what are each of your roles there?
Well, sure. I'll start and talk a little bit about the history of our Academy of Grief and Loss. Hamilton's Academy of Grief and Loss is a division of Hamilton's Funeral Home here in Des Moines. And Hamilton's Funeral Home is a family-owned funeral home. It's the largest funeral home in Iowa. We have six locations in central Iowa, and it is my family's business. And a little over 20 years ago, my dad and I collaborated and came up with this concept of providing a very extensive resource to our community, and we named it Hamilton's Academy of Grief and Loss. Our goal being to be a linking organization to other grief resources, but also provide support, resources, and education for people not just here in central Iowa and in the state of Iowa, but really all around the country. And over our 20 plus years, that's definitely what we've grown to become. And one of the things that we do during the school year that we're very busy with is providing grief support in our local schools. And so we really have been the key resource for schools with grief-related issues, whether it's a crisis-based situation or we're just providing grief support for students who've had a personal loss. And then, as I said, we link with other grief resources in our area to connect grieving folks with the resources that we need. And we publish a very extensive, almost 40-page book of community resources that is also on our website, but we print copies of that booklet so we can get that in people's hands as well. So that was a super brief, in a nutshell, overview of the Academy.
Okay, thank you. And what is your role there today?
So my role began as the founder, and I ran the academy division of our company for many, many years. Fast forward to today, and I now have Buffy Peters, who is the director of our academy, and we have a full-time academy coordinator, Becca, who works under Buffy, helping just keep the wheels rolling. And then I act more like a consultant now, because with the family business, I'm needed to do a lot more of the corporate aspects of the company. But the academy can't get rid of me, so I'm very involved in our children's grief programs that we run, and also those school groups that I mentioned. And then the other piece I'm most involved with is speaking and training and doing presentations across the country on the topic of grief and loss. Mm-hmm. So I'm more of a consultant now.
Uh-huh. Fantastic.
But I also do all that other stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's
She's
great.
Like a part-time.
Uh-huh. That's right. Great. Well, I'm glad you can come and share all your wisdom with us today. Thank you. So, and then Buffy. So Sasha got a little bit into your role, but can you tell us who you are, please?
Yeah, so I am the director of the Academy of Grief and Loss, and I actually joined Hamilton's, it'll be 5 years ago in August, and started as the coordinator. And so I learned a lot from Sasha and our previous director, Carrie. And when she left for a position in Colorado, Sasha asked if I would be interested in being the director. And since I knew kind of how everything ran, I was glad to take that opportunity. And started that last October. So it's been a fun, kind of crazy ride, my time here at Hamilton's. And a few other things I wanted to add to what Sasha said about what we provide through the academy. Of course, we are a part of the funeral home, so there are certain services that we do provide outside of the funeral service that the funeral directors provide for our families. And one of those is we just got done doing a first view for a family, and that's when there's children involved. So this particular instance was a dad died, and there were two kids, an 11 and 6-year-old, where they were going to see their dad for the first time at the funeral home. And so that's something that we do quite often, is to help prepare the kids what they're going to see when they walk into the room, what their person looks like, that sort of thing. So there's certain things that we provide just for our families, but most of what we provide through the academy really is for the community. And that's something that's really unique for a funeral home to do, is really do that care for the community as a whole, regardless of what funeral home that they used. So we work a lot with kids, like Sasha said, with our grief groups in the school. We also have our children's grief programs. So Sasha and I were kind of joking around about, we just started one this week for our Healing Hearts kids that are first through sixth graders, and we always do a parent meeting, and so this kind of feels like what we do in our parent meeting, of what you can expect, what's normal, concerns that they might have. So we do this all the time for lots of different families, lots of different causes of death. So we're really excited, Jenny, that you reached out to us and to be talking to you guys today.
Well, that's great. Yeah, and I was going to ask if this is unusual for funeral homes, because I have to say the funeral home that we used, which was excellent at providing funeral services, had nothing like this. So I think it's really great that you guys have added this into your program. I think I read that you even give tours of the funeral home and the, is it called a crematory?
We sure do.
Yeah.
Yes, we do.
Yeah.
Yes. We're all about education, and we've actually been doing tours for interested people and groups for like years. I mean, since probably the 1950s.
Wow.
So some aspects of the academy have existed on their own for a long, long time, but it was 20 plus years ago that we kind of put all that under one umbrella and started to grow that division as its own.
Yeah. Okay. That's great. So let's just jump right into the questions here, because I have so many questions for you guys after going through your fantastic information. And like you said, the parent meetings that you guys do, this will be great. So, okay, jumping right in. Is there any language that people should avoid when they're talking with kids about death? You know, there's a lot of cliches that you hear. Are those helpful? Are those not helpful? And is there, you know, what do you suggest in that regard?
Well, I'll pass the baton to Buffy in a minute because this is one of her favorite topics. But I'm going to just start by saying one thing that we try to coach and teach all adults, but especially when we're working with parents in our children's grief groups, is to avoid all the euphemisms that we adults use in our language, because we avoid saying died, we avoid saying death. And there are so many euphemisms for causes of death as well. And that is only confusing to children. Children do fine just hearing the real word. It's the adults that are uncomfortable using the real word. And I don't know how many times I've heard a grown-up say to me, but Sasha, it's just so harsh if I say that grandma died. And when I have them stop and think about that and answer the question, well, what's harsh about it? They can't really answer. What's really happening is it's hard for them to say that word because it makes it so real. But it helps the children understand what in the world's going on. And so when we use euphemisms, especially with young children, they take those literal. And so if we're telling the child that grandma's sleeping or has gone on a long trip or something like that, or we've lost grandpa, they're going to take that literally, and kids just want to fix it. So let's go find grandpa then if he's lost.
Okay. Yeah. That makes sense.
It's definitely one of my favorite subjects because people are so uncomfortable with it, and we have to begin to be comfortable talking about death and dying. Really, if we can do that, we're going to make more of our lives when we can actually use those words and get comfortable with that. And we have adults, like Sasha said, all the time saying, but that language is so harsh. For kids, they're so literal. They need that language. If we say passed away, an older kid might be able to grasp that. You know, if we have like an 11-year-old, they may understand what that means, but our 6-year-old doesn't. And like I said, when we do that first viewing support, the first thing that we're talking about is your person died. Do you know what that means? Because even if a family uses grandma died and we don't stop to explain what died means to a young child, they're not going to fully understand that. So we really talk about when we say someone has died, that their body has stopped working. Even a 4-year-old is going to understand that the body has stopped working. And right. Then we go through, okay, so can they still breathe? Does their brain work? Can they move their arms? All of that kind of stuff, they can understand those functions have ceased. So we start really basic like that. And then you can incorporate, depending on the cause of death, explaining how they died. Now, a 4-year-old may not be super interested in that the heart stopped working because they had a heart attack. Those questions may come later, but we need to be really honest with kids, as honest as we can, giving them the information that they need to start to understand what happened to their loved one. We kind of err on the side of under answering a little bit, starting with that base information and letting their questions lead what we give them. Like I said, a young kid may not really want to know all the details of the death, where that 11-year-old wants to know all the details of that death. So really just trying to gauge where they're at with developmental to know what kind of questions they might be asking, and then being as honest as we can with kids. We often see, of course, with stigmatized deaths such as suicide, overdose, even homicide, things like that, we want to protect our kids. We don't want to you know, of course, parents are worried about, you know, will they still love their person if it was a suicide and we tell them how they died, and all those different things they have concerns about. And the wonderful thing that we do for our families, as you saw, Jenny, on our website, is we do have those printable resources talking about how do we talk to kids about suicide? How do we talk to them about a substance-related death or cremation, death in general? So we put together those packets and talk through that with the families. How do we talk to the kids about that? And when a child doesn't know all of the facts of the death, they're going to make it up in their head. And often that is much more scary than what the reality is. Just a quick story, like I was telling you before, we just did a first view for a family, and their, what they had in their mind was very, very different than what they were going to go see when they saw their dad for the first time. And that's a real gift that we can give those families, that those kids could see their dad and see the reality of that. So we just need to be honest as we can with kids. And we're big proponents that we let them know that cause of death.
Mm-hmm. And using the real words too, Jenny. I think it's really important. I coach parents a lot on this, that they need to hear the real name for the cause of death. Even if they're 3 or 4, and they don't know what that means, they need to hear it because they're going to hear the grown-ups using that word. So, for example, if it's a certain type of cancer, I want the child to hear what kind of cancer it is. And even if the child can't say it or spell it, they need to hear it, and then we can explain it at their level. Because otherwise, what do we say to kids? Oh, your mom was sick. No, she was sick with cancer, and the type of cancer was called neuroblastoma, mm-hmm. or breast cancer, or whatever it is. So they hear the real name of it, and then we can talk at their level and help them understand. And my rule of thumb when I'm talking to a child, if I'm trying to help them understand maybe what the type of sickness was or the cause of death, I'll say the real name of it, whatever it is, and then I'll ask them, do you know what that means? And then if they don't, I'll explain it at what I think would be a level of their understanding, and I'll be very brief. And then I say, does that make sense? And then not, do you understand? Because if I say, do you understand, a child is going to probably say yes, because they don't want to say, oh, I don't understand, because that means they don't get it, or they're dumb, or I don't want them to feel that way. I want to know if I am making sense. It's much easier for a child to say, no, Sasha, you're not making sense to me. Then it's on me. Then it's on me and not on the child. I don't want it to be on the child that they're needing to understand this. So that's an easy way, as Buffy was describing, how we let the children lead us with their questions. If I say, does that make sense? You know what? It's either yes or no. Or they might say, kinda. If they say kinda, I know I need to say a little bit more and help them understand.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. And some parents wonder, like, how much information to give. And with that, ask them leading us with their questions. If a child is old enough to ask that question, they're old enough to hear the answer. And again, just trying to remember that what's in their mind is much different, and can be really scary. So if we can give them those pieces of information, that's when they really can start to grieve. If they're hung up on the hows and the whys and the whats, it really can impede their grief process, because they're so preoccupied trying to figure out what happened that they really can't take that step towards grieving the death of someone that they love.
Mm-hmm. And that is so important, what Buffy just stated, because that shows us the kids are fact finders, and that's first and foremost in their mind. They are trying to figure it out. They need and want and deserve the facts. And in fact, they're not going to stop till they get them. And if no one's giving them to them, they'll provide them themselves. And that's what Buffy was referring to. Because they want to move forward. They want to get to the grief part. You know, that is an innate, natural response to the death of someone loved is to be able to grieve and honor them. And they want to do that, but it's very hard if you don't know the facts.
So to take an example, let's say a parent died of something like a suicide, a drug overdose, maybe a homicide. And if the adults around the kid either are kind of hush-hush or they make up something, oh, well, he died of a heart attack or something.
Right.
What kind of problems does that create, or why do you advise against that?
So it really is pretty black and white. And when I'm talking with parents, they don't realize, they're like Buffy said earlier, they're trying to protect. Mm-hmm. And they don't realize that, no, actually, you're lying. And so, and no parent wants to lie to their kid. Number one, that's not teaching them well. And number two, you're then breaching trust. And the trust of a child is precious. And so when a parent realizes that a half truth or no truth it equals a lie, that really helps them to stop and think, oh, I didn't think about it that way. And that, so that's number one. And then number two is I can just about guarantee 110% that the child will find out the truth. Mm. They will. It may not be tomorrow, but it may. It may be in a couple of weeks. It may be in a couple of years. And think about, what does that do to the relationship when they discover they have not been told the truth all of this time? And maybe it was a short time, but that is very impactful to kids. We want them to learn the truth from the people that care about them most. That's the person that can hug them and hold them and cry with them and talk more about it together. Mm-hmm. Not a stranger, not the media, not the neighbor kid down the street, not the friend at school.
Mm-hmm. It almost sounds like a parent could take a really awful situation and almost make it worse if they add into that, creating some situation where the kid now can't trust their surviving parent because of the way they handled it.
Yep, and they know when you're holding back. They know when they're not getting the full answer. They do. They're smart, and they hear things. And there's nothing wrong with, maybe it's been a week or 2 weeks or a month or a year or whatever, and if her parent realizes, oh my gosh, I really should have told them the truth. There's nothing wrong with admitting we made a mistake. That helps them learn that you can come back from that and to be able to say, sweetheart, listen, I just need to talk to you about this. You know, I messed up. I should have told you sooner. This is just really hard for me. And I wanted to make sure that the way that I told you was the best way possible. And I know I should have told you sooner, but these are the facts. And I just wanted to make sure that you had that. So it's not like if you didn't tell them from the get-go, and you realize, oh my gosh, I really should have done that better. You can admit your mistakes. That helps them learn. And then now they know, okay, now we can have those conversations. And those are the people that you want to be having the conversation with. We want kids to trust their parents and know, especially when it's a parent that's died, to think that my other parent has been holding out on me. I want to be able to trust them and say, like, I'm really struggling. My dad died by suicide. Didn't he love me enough to stay around? Why did he do that? And to be able to talk those things through. And it's okay if, as a parent, I don't know that answer. I don't know why he did that. And to say, sweetheart, I don't know. I wonder about that too. Let's talk a little bit more about that. There's nothing wrong with saying, I don't know. What do you think? Or let's talk about that together and see if we can come up with something.
Yeah. Well, I was going to actually ask you about that next, because, I mean, as we all know, kids ask lots and lots of questions. And sometimes we don't know the answers, either because they're unknowable or because we're not experts in everything. So it sounds like you're suggesting that if a kid is asking questions we don't know, we shouldn't avoid them.
Right.
It's okay to say, I don't know, but let's find out. Let's do research. Let's talk to so-and-so.
Exactly. One of the things I love to say to children, no matter what their question is that is a great question. Mm. Thank you for asking that question. Mm-hmm. Even if my next words are going to be, I don't know either, and it's okay. It is hard for parents to say, I don't know sometimes. Mm-hmm. But I really want to, if I am constantly saying, wow, what a great question, I just am keeping that door open so that the child knows they can ask me more questions. Mm-hmm. Now, here's a tricky part for parents. Kids will ask their questions. They will make their statements out of the blue. They're not like going to usually say, Mom, now I have a question for you, and it might be kind of hard for you, but I'm going to ask it. They don't do that. They just blurt it out, which is wonderful, but it can take parents off guard. And sometimes the question can cause maybe a swelling of emotion for that parent, and they begin to cry. And then that child believes that they're the ones that cause their parent to cry, not understanding that, no, it's the grief that's right on the surface 24/7 that just leaked out right then when the question was asked. And so I don't want to discourage parents when that happens. If they need a minute, they just need to tell their child and still say, oh, what a great question. And I'm not crying because you asked me a question. I'm crying because I miss Daddy. So that the child, that is immediately taken from the child, so they aren't feeling to blame. Because children, as you probably well know, Jenny, can feel just as guilty as adults about so many things, about the death, about their other parents' grief, about whatever it may be. Children can really carry a lot of guilt. They also like to fix the world, and so they want to fix Mommy or Daddy's tears. And so they might avoid asking questions because they don't want to make them cry. So anything we can do or say to continue to encourage questions, but know that your grief is important too. And if you're not able to answer right now, you need to tell our kids. Like, that is a really great question, and I need some time though, and let's talk about that after dinner.
Yeah.
So the child knows, okay, I can wait till after dinner for that.
And I want to make sure, I think what I heard you saying is it's very, very important to make explicit to the kid that I'm not crying because of your question. You didn't cause me
right.
to cry. Okay. That even though you might think the child, of course, would understand that it sounds like it's important to really explicitly say.
It really is, because they're literal, and what they saw is cause and effect. I asked my question, and Mommy is now crying.
Okay.
So what else are they supposed to deduce from that?
Sure. Yeah. Sure. Okay. Right. So to kind of break that link. And so that I guess reminds me, I mean, it kind of gets into the topic of the child seeing the parent grieving. I guess, do you have any thoughts about the importance of it, or how the parent can model healthy grieving for their child?
Yeah, we think it's really important for the parents to show that they're grieving too.
Yes.
Communication is huge in any and all relationships, but especially with your children. And so if you can let them know, you know, whether it is they brought up a memory or there's something that they said that triggered you crying, to being honest about that. Because again, you didn't make me cry. I'm really missing Daddy too. And so I'm crying because I'm sad. And that also helps them start to understand feelings. If you can label them for kids, this is how I'm feeling right now, or this is what's going on with me right now, and it's called, that can really help them identify their feelings inside themselves as well. So that's really what that modeling is doing. It's helping them to understand what they might be going through, and what they see in their brain. Okay, this is acceptable grieving. This is not acceptable grieving. And so that really helps kids to understand it in that way. Now, if you're hysterically crying all of the time, they may grow concerned with you. And so there's that kind of level that we want to be kind of concerned with, that maybe if we're sobbing, you know, ugly crying in our pillow, They might hear that and that's okay, but really talking through those things with kids. We don't want them to be so concerned with us, but we also want to model that behavior so they know it's okay to grieve. And as Sasha said before, that it's a natural, normal response when we have someone that we love that has died.
It almost sounds like you're shooting for a Goldilocks type approach here. Not too little, not too much, but kind of that sweet spot of showing them that you can grieve and that you can handle it.
Right. And I think, but that maybe sounds a little unattainable. Like, how do I find the sweet spot?
Okay, all right.
So I think when you are having a tough day, all we need to do is communicate what Buffy just said. And you say, honey, I am really having a tough grief day today. And so you might see me crying more than usual. I mean, just verbalizing what's going on in my life today.
Okay.
And we know, and those of you listening know how grief ebbs and flows. And there's days when it's super intense. And then there are days when I'm feeling a little stronger today, right? I mean, that just happened to me this week. My mom died at Christmas time, and I've kind of been doing okay, I guess. And then this week in the morning, I don't know what my problem was. It was actually yesterday. I was just feeling very weepy or something, and I don't even know what triggered that. And I thought, wow, this is a tough grief day for me. And so if we can just be open with our kids about that, how healthy is that for them to hear that? Oh, okay. So there's tough grief days and then maybe days that are better. And so that open communication, I think parents sometimes, we don't want to burden our kids. And I get that. I don't want to burden my kids either. And I would tell them, I don't need you to fix it. I just need you to know that I'm struggling today a little bit, but I'll probably be better tomorrow.
Right.
At the parent meeting that we just had this week for our Healing Hearts group, I was speaking with the parents about that because I had parents that were crying during my meeting and they had spouses die. And I talked about, said, I'm seeing you cry and I'm so proud of you that you're crying. And they look at me like, what are you talking about? I said, I hope your kids see that. And I talked about, you know, seeing hysterical parents is scary, but seeing parents that are just grieving naturally, it is so healthy for them. I've worked with kids where that healthy model is not present, and kids will model that and they'll keep it all inside. And it can't stay inside forever. So it ends up exploding in their teenage years or at some inopportune time, or they end up making some very poor choices in their lives because they've kept that bottled up because for whatever reason, the rule of thumb after that parent died was, we're not talking about it ever again. We're putting all the memories and mementos away and suck it up and get over it and move forward. Not healthy grieving. Not healthy grieving, especially for kids.
Right. Okay. That makes a lot of sense. And I also think the point that you mentioned about clarifying to the kids that, you know, I am sad. You don't have to fix it. I just wanted to let you know what's happening with me. I think that's a really important point as well. And then that reminds me then, because that, you know, so I guess what you're saying is don't place that burden on the child.
Yeah. Right.
Other burdens that you sometimes see people, well-meaning adults, trying to place onto a child. And I ask this question, one reason I ask it is I'm thinking about a case, my kids are Korean, and we have, my son gets his hair cut by a Korean woman who's very nice, and she talks to him about Korean things. And anyway, right after my husband died, she said to him, who was 12 at the time, 11, you need to be the man of the house now. You need to take care of your mother. And I think it was probably coming from her own experience. But I'm wondering, what do you think about, is that something that you still hear these days?
Absolutely, Jenny. We hear that all the time. And it sounds so, it is. They're saying it, they're being caring. What they don't understand, they're not putting themselves in that child's shoes, because children, they will take that seriously and feel like, oh my goodness, I do need to be the man of the house. I do need to take care of mom. And that is not what your 11-year-old needs to do. Your 11-year-old needs to be an 11-year-old, not all of a sudden become the man of the house. Mm-hmm. But people say that all the time. It's a cliche. They don't know what else to say, and they're trying to be supportive. But we hear that a lot. We, of course, the being strong. You need to be strong for your mom or your surviving parent. Mm-hmm. We also hear a lot about other burdens, I think, is expectations of roles. And that man of the house one is an example. But people saying to the child, maybe it's an extended family member or friend saying, well, now, you know, make sure you do extra chores to help your mom out or to help your dad out. You know, your dad doesn't know how to cook, so make sure, Jenny, that you are doing all the cooking. I mean, people say crazy things, and then these kids, what a burden that is. What do you say to that when you're a 10 or 11-year-old? I mean, they're not going to say no. They're going to think about that and say, oh, wow, I really need to do that. And that is so not healthy at all. And I've seen kids take that literally and truly, truly try to do some of those adult jobs in the home. And it's not good. They're not being a kid anymore. A kid needs to be a kid even in their grief. A couple of other things that I want to bring up about the undue burdens question that you asked, Jenny, that parents can be careful of is when you are comparing your child to the person who died. So if it's your spouse who died and you're comparing them, especially if you're comparing them and you're frustrated.
Hmm.
Oh, that is just like your dad. And you learned that from your dad. And saying some negative things, saying positive things is wonderful. Kids are so proud of that. Say, oh, when you say that or when you do that gesture, it reminds me so much of your mom.
Hmm.
They're proud of that. Or your blue eyes are the same color as your dad's. I love that. Because they're a part of who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And so those are positive. But when you're comparing them in anger, and that can happen, that is not advised. And then the second thing that's really a pet peeve of mine, Jenny, is when, and parents don't, it's not just parents that do this. Other people do this to kids, especially in times when they're wanting the kids to, work on some sort of improvement in their life, whether it's studying or sports or just kind of get with the program, they will say to the child, now, Tommy, your dad would really want you to go out for baseball. So, or your mom would really want you to be studying hard, or your dad would really want you to be happy and not sad all the time. Those are impossible expectations.
Mm.
There is no person on earth that can live up to a dead person's expectations that a living person is putting on that child. And I hate that when adults do that to kids. Now, on the flip side of the coin, a kid might verbalize that. They might say to me, Sasha, you know, my dad would really want me to study hard and do well in school. That is completely different. If the child is telling me that about themselves, that that's what they believe, then if an adult is putting that weight on that child and saying, you should do this because your deceased parent would want this, that is completely unfair to that child. They cannot live up to that. That is dangerous.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. So if a parent, if a surviving parent, then if a child says to them, oh, I, you know, the example you just said, I think my dad would really want me to fill in the blank, right? What would what would be an appropriate or effective response from the parent if the kid makes a statement like that on their own?
Well, I would assume that they're doing it in a positive way, right? In almost all the circumstances I can think of, that's a positive. You know, dad would really want me to do this positive thing. And then I might say, oh, you know, tell me more why you think that. And I would want to validate that for them, but I would want to know a little bit more. Because if the child then says, well, I don't, you know, I don't want them to be disappointed. I don't want them to begin putting burdens on themselves. So I can agree and say, yep, I bet, you know, if daddy were here, he'd be so proud of you. That's very different from saying, you know, if I say, you know, if daddy were here, he would be so proud. That's very different than saying, now you need to do this because that's what your dad wants or that's what he would want.
Okay. Gotcha. All right. That makes sense. Gosh, I have so many questions for you guys. I think we could talk all day here. Let's get to some other ones here. I'm wondering, are there any, like, what kinds of secondary losses are there? I mean, obviously the primary loss is someone died, one of the parents died. But what goes along with that in terms of other secondary losses that maybe parents aren't immediately aware of or thinking about?
I think we talk with adults and kids about secondary losses all the time. And Jenny, just like you said, we have that primary loss that somebody has died. And then there's all these other things that change. And sometimes we think, we readily think about it, like if we had one of our parents dies and now we have a loss of income, we may have to move. There's a secondary loss. We also might have change of schools, those types of things that we think of, like, okay, this happened, now all these different changes happen. Knowing, though, that those other losses also cause grief.
Right.
So maybe you are a year out, and of course, are one of my biggest things that I don't like is when we say, well, it's been a year, you should be over it by now, right? We all know when we've had someone special die, that is not the case. When we have someone that we love that dies, that grief, it stays with us, especially when it's a parent. That child is going to re-grieve at different developmental stages. And so just knowing that if it's a year out and now we've moved and all of a sudden here's some behaviors that we haven't seen in a while, maybe they're acting out because they don't feel like they can talk about it. Knowing that those things also cause grief. I think, too, sometimes we don't think about it, but the daddy-daughter dance. Well, okay, uncle's going to step in, so it's all right that your dad died. That child's going to be grieving that, that they're different, and that my dad's not here, and look at all these other dads, even though uncle or grandpa or somebody else was able to step in so I didn't miss out, I'm still missing that. And so just knowing those types of things that really can cause some re-grief, as I said, at different points in their lives. That's really important, I think, for families to really be aware of.
I like to have people think about that secondary losses are timeless. They're not just past things or present things, but they're also future things. And so if you had any person, a child or adult or teen, make a list of the secondary losses they can think of, like Buffy mentioned, having to move, loss of income, you know, dad was my softball coach, and so he's now not my softball coach, and just all of those types of things, they can list all of those, but we can never finish the list because the secondary losses are in the future. They're in the future too. So they're the next upcoming holidays. They're the next, any special day, you name it, birthday, but their graduation, their wedding, their birth of a baby, all of these that we don't even know yet what those are going to be and when our grief is going to kind of catch up to us. I remember when my first son was born, I had never crossed my mind, but all of a sudden I was really struggling because I had two grandparents that had already died and they would never meet their first great grandchild. He would have been their very first great grandchild ever and they never got to meet him. I didn't think about that ahead of time till I'm holding baby in my arms thinking, oh my gosh. And that made me so sad. So I couldn't have anticipated that because I just wasn't on my radar. And so that's going to happen for kids too. And it's going to happen for us as adults. But that's not to, we're not saying that to overwhelm anyone. We're saying that so that they realize this is normal and this is part of grief and it helps us to prepare.
So you're talking about losses then present and future over lots of time periods. And I wonder, I know everybody's experience of grief, you know, is different, but are there any kind of generalized timelines of when maybe many people experience certain challenges or certain ups and downs in this process that maybe you could shed some light on?
Well, I think as, you know, Buffy kind of hinted at this a little bit when she was talking about secondary losses. And it is kind of when those time frames sneak up on us that our grief can become more intense, or when children reach a different developmental stage. And when they reach a different stage in development and they understand the meaning of that loss in a new way, it's almost like they're regrieving, like Buffy said, or they're almost starting over, which can feel very overwhelming to the surviving parent when mm-hmm. they feel like they've already gone through this once or twice and now here we go again. The other time, Jenny, would be when there's a big change in the family. So maybe it is a parent getting remarried, which is a very positive thing, hopefully, right, for everyone. And they're thinking, you know, what's wrong with my kid? They love this new person in our lives. They have a great relationship, and yet I'm seeing this behavior, or I'm seeing this grief that I wasn't expecting, and that's because of this change in the family. I've had that happen so many times where I'll hear from a parent that I haven't heard from for a few years, and they're all of a sudden struggling with their child again. And before the parent even tells me, I'm guessing, I bet they're about to get remarried. And that's almost always what it is. The other thing, Jenny, is when there's another death in the family, that will bring up the old grief. Mm. And that's normal and natural. That doesn't mean that we did anything wrong or that we didn't grieve enough or any of that. But that grief that we just were so familiar with for however long can kind of, for lack of a better term, rear its ugly head as we're facing a new loss. That can happen for people of all ages.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And on the topic of different developmental milestones of the kid, I guess just to give an example, it sounds like one of those might be as the child is maybe moving from childhood into beginning puberty, that it's not just body changes, but their brain is significantly changing as well, and their cognitive,
right?
So that's one example of what you're talking about, of a new developmental stage.
Exactly, exactly correct. And just how they understand what death means, and in particular, what that relationship meant to them as well. They'll understand that differently. And so that could be triggered, like Buffy said, with the daddy-daughter dance. Here, the child's been doing pretty well, and then boom, here's the daddy-daughter dance, and it's just so difficult for them because they are understanding the meaning of this loss for them in a new way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think it's important, too, for us adults, like our grief, when compared to a child's grief, seems a little bit more stable, if you can ever call grief stable, where we're experiencing it pretty much all the time. And kids go back and forth. So they may, you know, we might tell the six-year-old, daddy died, and he's like, okay, can I go play? and they're kids. And so they're really good at, okay, I'm going to come back then and ask those questions later, while me as dad, I'm experiencing it the whole entire time. And so ours may feel a little bit more stable because it's more constant. Maybe that's a better word for it, where kids are kind of coming in and out of it. And sometimes, like you had mentioned, Jenny, about puberty, when we know that that's coming up, it's like, okay, that makes sense that that's changing. Well, maybe their development, if they found out that our person died when we were 5, and then now we're 7 or 8, and that understanding of, okay, they really are never coming back.
Right.
And they're going to maybe ask those same questions they asked before, but their intention behind that question is very different because their understanding is different. And so sometimes it may be a little bit more subtle as to, okay, their development has been changing, hasn't it? And they're understanding that in a new way. And so they're wanting more details about this or more details about that, versus, you know, going from kind of childhood into puberty when it's a little bit like, okay, yeah, that you are understanding that in a different way. And really just understanding for all of us that as long as we love that person, that grief is with us. There is no time frame on that. It's just maybe our understanding is going to be different as a child. Or as Sasha's pointed out with those secondary losses, my grandma died when I was 10. So my understanding was different then versus when I graduated from high school. And I was a mess because she didn't get to see me graduate. And I wondered, would she be proud of me and all of that? So understanding that, even as for us adults, that comes and rears its ugly head at different times that we may not expect.
Mm-hmm. I think it's important to, Buffy said that perfectly, but that doesn't give us an excuse to wait until we think the child is ready to understand, right? It does that back to the beginning of our conversation. It doesn't give us an excuse to not tell the children the truth because, well, they don't quite understand it yet. No, not at all. We still need to be open and honest with them no matter how young or old they are, no matter what their understanding is, and then re-answer those questions as they understand them when they get older. So I don't want anyone to think, oh, well, I'll just wait till puberty then to tell the truth. That will backfire.
Okay, so it's more of an iterative process and repetitive and, yeah, and that they might be asking a lot of the same questions over and over again, and that's okay.
Yes.
And as time goes on, it might be the same questions, but to a new level of understanding.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Exactly.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. Are there some other kind of misconceptions or misunderstandings that adults might have about children and how they grieve and how all this affects them or what they are or aren't capable of doing in this whole process?
I think a big one is that kids are too young to grieve. And we hear this a lot with even 4-year-olds. We have a group, as Sasha was talking about, our Healing Hearts is for that 1st through 6th graders that we're doing right now. We also have one for 4 to 6.5-year-olds. And often people are like, well, a 4-year-old, surely they're too young to understand. And so it's that understanding. We don't give them enough credit. And so understanding that even a 2-year-old is going to notice that someone that they love is gone. They're going to notice your behaviors, all of that. And so just really for us to keep in mind that 2-year-old, no, they're not going to understand the words that we're saying, but we can begin to have those conversations because that's how they learn. And really kind of gauging it on their understanding. I think that's a big one that we hear a lot of is, well, that 4-year-old, they don't get it. They don't really understand. And just telling you from working with the 4-year-olds and 3-year-olds and all of that, they understand a whole lot more than we give them credit for. And I think too, like I had mentioned earlier about, you know, the 6-year-old that we tell, well, mommy died, and we're, you know, giving them the information, and then they're ready to go play, that like, oh my gosh, are they okay? Like, is that normal? Just knowing that their grief is different than ours, but they're going to come back and ask those questions if we make sure that we're answering them as they ask them as well.
So can I add on to that, Jenny?
Absolutely.
I Buffy just kind of handed me the baton here, because another difference between children's grief and adults, Buffy already talked about how adult grief is constant. We don't turn our grief off and on. I mean, it permeates every aspect of our being all the time. When we're sleeping, when we're awake, when we're brushing our teeth, when we're making dinner, when we're shopping, it's there. Children have a wonderful ability. I'm not quite sure at what age it goes away, but they have the ability to do what I call, they can put their grief in their pocket. And so they can have their grief out in their hand, and it can be right there on the surface. Tears are falling. I'm missing my special person. And then on a dime, they can just put that in their pocket and go play. And we cannot do that. We can try it, but it usually doesn't work very well. Or we have to fake it. Kids truly can put their grief away. And then they can bring it back out at will. And so that's something I wanted to talk about to this audience, because this is a frustration to parents and also a concern that I hear a lot is, how do I know when my kid is actually grieving or when they're using their grief to manipulate me?
Ah, okay, good. I'm interested to hear what you have to say about this.
Right. And so the magical answer is, don't even waste your time trying to figure out which is the real grief and which is manipulation. Here's what you do. Typically, when this is occurring and the parents are frustrated, they're wondering, okay, my kid just really misbehaved and really broke the rules in my home, but I don't know, maybe they're using the excuse that they miss mommy or they miss daddy, but I don't know. I think they're trying to manipulate me, but I can't really tell. Okay, that's what I'm hearing. Now, sometimes you can totally tell, right? Mm-hmm. But another time it's like, I don't know. Like, do I punish that? Like, if they're really, really grieving, maybe I should let that go? And my answer is no, don't let that go. Here's why. When a child has had a significant caregiver, especially, who has died in their life, so that might be a parent, a mom or dad, or maybe a grandparent that helped care for them, their sense of security has been threatened, right? Because that person is now gone. That was out of their control. And our job is to help that child begin slowly to rebuild that sense of security. We as parents help rebuild that, especially through two things. One is routine, so the child knows what to expect in their day. That's another conversation. And two is rules. Okay, so now this all ties together, don't worry. But so now we've had a child who's just taken their grief out of their pocket. They're hysterical. They're having a temper tantrum. Whatever's happening, they've just broken a very big rule in the home. And they're saying, but I miss my daddy. And they can hardly breathe because they're crying so hard. But you have another child who just got slapped by that kid in anger. So you're, what do I do with this, right? Okay, so here's what we need to do. Whatever rules were true in your home prior to the loss, prior to the death of that person, need to still be in force after the death. Now, sometimes that's exhausting, okay? So you got to pick your battles. But if you can be characterized by enforcing those rules, so child's just broken a rule, they're using the quote excuse of their grief, I don't want you to decide if it's real or not. I want you to assume it's real. So you're going to say to that child who's crying hysterically, honey, I know you miss daddy. I know, and I do too. And then what I just did is I validated the grief, real or not, I validated it. And then you use a magic three-letter word, and it's the word but. So honey, I know you miss daddy so much. And I do too. But that does not mean that you can slap your sister. That does not mean you can talk back to me. That does not mean you can throw your toys. Whatever rule it is, I'm going to say, but that doesn't mean you break the rules that we have in place at our home. And so because you did that, you now must go to your room in timeout. You've lost this privilege of playing on your iPad. Whatever the consequences are, follow through. So I validated the grief. I did not have to figure it out. I validated it, real or not. I said, but here's the rule in our home, honey, and you must still abide by those. And the child's not going to love this, but what's happening is I am going to be helping their sense of security to grow because they now know what to expect. And if that's not in place in a home, a child has no idea what to expect. Like, well, last time I got in trouble for this, but the time before I didn't, so I'll just do it. You see what I'm saying?
Right, okay.
So I have found that to be really a helpful tool for parents who are trying to figure out, I don't know when it's real, I don't know when it's fake. You know what? Just don't go there.
Yeah.
Just validate it. Just validate it and then enforce your rule.
Right. Okay. That makes a lot of sense. And thank you for talking about that. And I'm thinking if I could draw another theme maybe out of there, this theme of validating the child's grief, generally speaking, across the board, not invalidating it and not trying to tuck them out of their grief, or I'm assuming that that's also an important point for parents to keep in mind here.
Yeah. Well, and I think Jenny, you said it perfectly. Like anybody who's grieving, we want our grief to be validated.
Uh-huh.
We know it's real. Our experience is very real to us, and we want to know that somebody else is listening and somebody else gets it. Now, as the parent, we don't, maybe we do know, but we probably don't know what it's like for them to have had their mom die. But you do know what it's like to lose that specific person. And so just making sure that we validate their experience, because that's the same thing that we want. We want our experience validated. And one thing that we hear often from people is, so if I'm a child and I'm saying, I just feel really guilty that mom died and I feel like it's my fault. Our usual response is we want to save people and we don't want them to feel bad, especially if we're a parent. We really don't want our kids to feel bad, but newsflash is they've had a parent die and so they're going to feel bad, right? And so instead of our natural response being, well, honey, you shouldn't feel that way. You know that you didn't do anything to make your mom die. Right? And we know that intellectually, we may know that she died of cancer. And so we didn't, like, there was nothing we could have done. It takes a long time for our brain and our heart to come to the same place. So we may know that intellectually that we didn't do anything. Our heart, though, feels like, but if only.
Yeah.
If I only was a good boy and I didn't, you know, do this, that, or whatever their magical thinking is telling them, if only I wouldn't have done that, then maybe they'd still be alive.
Right.
And so just really not taking that away. As Sasha said, we want to validate that experience. And then our magical phrase, we don't have any magical phrases, but here's our magical phrase,
right?
Is tell me more about that. And so you can see, okay, are they really not understanding the cause of death? Do they need more facts? Or do they really understand that? And it's just that guilt that they're feeling that we can help them work through. So whether that is encouraging them to draw pictures or journal or, you know, just depending on the age of the child, how can we help them work through that feeling? So it's not such a heavy burden on them.
Yeah.
I can't take it away, but how can I give them some of those tools to help them figure out how can they cope with that,
right?
And figure that out for themselves. And that's really what Sasha was talking about too, with that, okay, I know you're really missing daddy, but you can't hit your brother. So how can we come up with some ways of that physical anger, especially when it's been a traumatic death, the physical aggressive behaviors, how can we find a physical way to get that out that's not hitting our brother? Mm-hmm. How can we figure out, how can we, as Sasha, she always talks about this, connect those dots of, okay, you're angry. I see that and I get that you're angry. I'm angry that your dad is dead too. What can we do physically to get those feelings out that's not going to hurt yourself, not going to destroy anything else? And let's talk about that. Let's brainstorm. Let's come up with some ideas. And if we can enlist them in that, giving them, again, some control and some say, right, that can be really, really helpful for kids because, they, as Sasha said too, they've lost all control. The people who are always supposed to be there in their entire life forever and ever and ever, one of them is now dead. And so how can we help them to gain a little bit more control in their life? Let's come up with some things together as a family that we can do when we're feeling really angry. Maybe it's going for a walk together in nature, or it's going to play basketball, or whatever it is that they already liked doing beforehand. And how can we connect that dot that, okay, now we can use that running out in the track. We can use that to get our feelings out, or we can use that to honor our special person because we're wearing their favorite color of socks at the next track meet. You know, those different things that we can help them figure out ideas of their own, or giving them some input of, oh, well, have you thought about maybe doing that?
Mm-hmm.
So Jenny, what Buffy just explained is really the next step beyond my in the moment. I'm dealing with a kid that just broke all the rules, mm-hmm. and I need to deal with that this moment. And then the next step is later, what Buffy exactly said is, you know, let's revisit you hitting your brother. So I just want to make sure to connect the dots there, that you're seeing, that the listeners can see that then the next step is, you know, let's talk about that behavior that happened and why it did, especially if we know that child, it was genuinely, they were grieving,
mm-hmm.
not just using it to manipulate. So that's that next step of, and that's really, that next step is really where we come in with our kids groups that we offer, is helping kids apart from their parents sometimes is the best way to come up with those ideas of good ways. And because kids, Jenny, will, most kids, I would say if you have a group of 10 kids in a room, 9 of them are going to agree that being angry is wrong. Feeling angry is wrong. Not understanding that it's not the anger that's wrong, but it's the subsequent behavior that occurs. So we want to help to distinguish that for kids. It's not the anger that's wrong. The anger is so normal and common and healthy, but hitting someone because you're angry, that's the piece that we need to redirect.
Okay. So separating the feelings and the emotions and the validity of all of those,
yes,
from the behaviors, then some of which might be okay and some of which might not be okay.
Exactly. But kids lump that together because what they know in their world is, when I do this thing, I get in trouble. And I do this thing because I'm feeling X. So then they just directly associate those two.
Gotcha. Okay. No, that makes a lot of sense. And I love, Buffy, one of the things you mentioned, maybe a tool for the toolkit, is the tell me more about that question.
Yeah.
Because I think so often as parents, you know, we want to fix everything. We want to have all the answers right away. As soon as it happens, deal with the situation, and then, you know, and move on. So I love that. Yeah. That, tell me more about it, getting a better sense of where they're coming from, what is really underneath this. And then Sasha, like you were talking about, the, you know, kind of the 1-2 of the deal with the immediate behavior and then the circle back later and be more maybe proactive about, because maybe some kind of plan.
The root of that, right.
Exactly. Okay, that's really helpful. Gosh, we could keep talking all day because, I mean,
I know.
You guys have so much knowledge and experience on this topic and such a wealth of information. And I'm afraid we're going to have to actually cut it off here, because otherwise, I don't know. I don't think listeners would stick with us for 4 hours, but maybe they would.
Oh, come on, guys.
Yeah. So I'll just ask one more question, maybe of each of you, starting with Sasha. If you could say one thing to widowed parents about supporting their grieving kids, what would it be?
I think my one thing, if I could only say one thing, I would just talk about the importance of grieving together as a family. And that really encapsulates everything we've talked about today. You can't grieve together if you haven't been honest. You can't grieve together if you haven't answered questions, if you haven't used the language. So if you're grieving together as a family, then you are planning ahead for special days. And hey guys, what should we do for mom or dad's birthday together? What are your ideas? And let's do this together. And that to me is it's so beautiful when families can do that. And when there's a big secret, we haven't told the kids the actual cause of death, that is such a burden on those parents then. They can't grieve together with their kids because they're not on the same page. They're not in the same boat at all. When you can all be together doing this thing together, then it ebbs and flows. And a lot of times when you're having a tough day, your kids are having a good day, and that's a great balance. Or your child's having a tough day, but you're feeling stronger and you can really support them. So that's what I would say.
Okay. All right. Thank you. And how about you, Buffy?
And I think mine goes very well with Sasha, as most of our points do. But I think communication is huge. As long as we're communicating, being honest, that way we can be together. And that way, too, you can get those ideas of how to better incorporate the kids in those honoring activities and different things like that. Often people want to leave because the kids are too young, right? They don't really understand. If we can incorporate them into, what are your guys' ideas? They usually have the best ideas of how we can continue to honor our people, even after they've died. And so if we can just communicate, whether it is how we're feeling, what we're doing, that's really key. And I think for parents too, just knowing we have to be gentle on ourselves. We have this big responsibility, but we're also grieving too. And so just giving ourselves permission to make those mistakes and saying, right, hey, you know what? I messed up. I should have done this, or I shouldn't have done that. And being honest and communicating those with our kids is huge, so that they can continue to learn and be a part of the grief as a family as a whole.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you. I think that's a great place to end. My guests today are Sasha Mudloff and Buffy Peters from Hamilton's Academy of Grief and Loss, which is part of Hamilton's Funeral Home in Des Moines, Iowa. And so, Buffy, let me ask you, where can listeners find you guys if they'd like to know more about your work and access your resources?
Yeah, the best place would be our website, which is hamiltonsfuneralhome.com. It's Hamilton's with an S, funeralhome.com. And just like Jenny found on there, we have lots of printable resources. Our contact information is on there as well. So feel free. We have people reach out to us from all over asking for our advice of how do I talk to my kids about this, or what would you recommend for books. We have a lending library with a lot of great kids books. Bibliotherapy is a great way to talk to your kids about especially those difficult topics, well, like grief, but like causes of death, some different things like that. So if you're ever looking for more information, visit our website and feel free to reach out to us. We'd be happy to help any way that we can.
And we have a Facebook page too, Buffy.
Oh yeah. And Facebook. We do have Facebook. So if you're on Facebook, we're Hamilton's Academy of Grief and Loss. We post pictures of our bunny, who's our mascot, Hamilton. The kids love him. And just the different goings on. And so people can contact us there as well if that's easier.
Okay. Fantastic. Well, Sasha and Buffy, thank you so much for speaking with me today.
Yeah, thank you, Jenny.
I hope you enjoyed my interview with Buffy Peters and Sasha Mudloff as much as I did. You can find show notes and all the links at widowedparentpodcast.com. Look for episode 19.
I hope you'll be able to join us this coming Sunday, April 7th, 2019, for our second ever podcast discussion group. It's like a book club, but for listeners of the podcast. I'll be queuing up some questions for discussion, and we can enjoy getting to know one another. If you didn't come last time, no worries, you're welcome to join us. It's free, but you do need to sign up at widowedparentpodcast.com. Also, please do share and rate and review in iTunes or whatever app you use to listen. I know I mention this most weeks, but it really is important to do this to help reach more widowed parents. That's all for this week. Thanks for listening. Until next week, keep smiling.
Thank you for listening to the Widowed Parent Podcast with your host, Jenny Lisk. Connect with us on social media and at widowedparentpodcast.com.